Hi, my name is Dr. Yasser Al-Humairi and today I will be performing the abdominal examination. First, you should start by introducing yourself and explaining your role and the nature of the examination to the patient. Then, take consent and ensure privacy.
Hi, my name is Dr. Yasser. I am a general practitioner and today I will be examining your abdomen, which will include me looking, feeling and listening to your tummy. Is that okay with you?
Yes, it's okay.
Be sure that no one will be entering the examination room or leave it during the examination.
Okay.
Remember, if the patient is from the opposite sex, you may ask for a chaperone. Next is HIPAA, which stands for hand washing, exposure of the patient, which in this case should be to the mid-thigh, but for now we will keep it to the suprapubic area. Position. First, the patient should be in 45 degrees, later we will be changing the position to 180 degrees. Appearance, which is basically the general inspection of the patient. So in our patient, he looks well and he is not in acute distress. We should also look for any signs of jaundice, pigmentation or cachexia. Now we will be moving to the hands, and here we will be looking for color and shape in the nails, palms and dorsum of the hands. In the nails, the color is leukonychia and shape is clubbing. In the palms, the color is palmar erythema and the shape is Dupuytren's contracture. In the dorsum of the hands, the color is tendon xanthoma and the shape or the movement is hepatic flap, which is due to hepatic encephalopathy. Ask the patient to hold this position for 30 seconds. Now our patient will demonstrate a positive hepatic flap. Moving to the arms, we have skin, muscles and blood vessels. In the skin, we look for scratch marks. In the muscles, we look for muscle wasting. And the blood vessels, we look for bruises, petechiae and spider nevi. Next is eyes inspection. We have four things to look for. Ask the patient to look up, looking for pallor. Ask the patient to look down, looking for jaundice. And at the center, looking for Kayser-Fletcher ring, which is in case of Wilson's disease. And the fourth sign is xanthalisma, which is a sign of hypercholesterolemia. Moving down for the rest of the face, we look for parotid enlargement, angular stomatitis or colitis in case of iron deficiency anemia, and inside the mouth we should check for four things: dental hygiene, atrophic glossitis, mucosal dehydration and smell. And we have two types of smell: bad smell, which is halitosis, can indicate GERD, and sweet smell, which is foetor hepaticus, and it can be a sign of liver failure. Now moving down to the neck, we should examine the cervical lymph nodes: submental, submandibular, preauricular, posterior auricular, anterior cervical chain, posterior cervical chain, occipital, supraclavicular, mainly the left side while the patient is shrugging his shoulders, which is a site for metastasis of gastric cancer. And you should also check the axillary lymph nodes. Then we have chest inspection. We look for gynecomastia, hair loss, and spider nevi. And they are all signs of liver failure or cirrhosis. Now we should change the position to supine or 180 degrees for the inspection of the abdomen. Ask the patient to breathe in and out deeply during the inspection. Check the umbilicus for symmetry or any abnormal movement with breathing. Then you should observe the abdomen from different views, starting from the edge of the bed while kneeling, then moving to the side looking for five signs. You can use the following mnemonic to memorize them. Look for B, C, D on your SP. B stands for bruises and we have two types: central, which is Cullen's sign, and it is a sign of acute hemorrhagic paniculitis. Paniculitis is inflammation of the subcutaneous adipose tissue. And on flanks, which is Gray Turner sign, and it is a sign of acute hemorrhagic pancreatitis. C for caput medusa, which is a sign of portal hypertension. D for distension in case of ascites. S for scars, in case of previous surgeries, P for visible peristalsis in case of intestinal obstruction. So next is the palpation part. In palpation, we have light and deep palpation. Before starting palpation, you should ask the patient whether he has pain in his abdomen. If yes, ask him to locate it and start palpating away from the painful site and end your palpation at the painful site. You should also ask the patient to cough. If the pain is exacerbated, then it is a sign of peritonitis. If there is no pain, you can start from any quadrant, making sure you palpate the whole abdomen. Starting with the light palpation, I will start with the left lower quadrant and I will make sure to look at the patient's face, which might give me a clue for pain. When finishing light palpation, I should comment on tenderness, rigidity or guarding, and masses. Then the same goes for deep palpation. And again, I have to comment on deep tenderness and deep masses. Next, we will be doing specific palpation and percussion. The order will be palpation plus percussion for the liver, palpation plus percussion for the spleen, palpation only for kidneys, and percussion only for ascites. Starting with the liver, we need to press during inspiration and move during expiration. We should start from the right lower quadrant on the midclavicular line. Ask the patient to breathe deeply in and out. If you didn't feel the lower edge of the liver, then consider the costal margin as the lower edge of the liver. Then, for the upper edge of the liver, we should start percussing from the second intercostal space on the midclavicular line and go down till we feel dullness on percussion. Then we should mark it as the upper edge of the liver. Now we can measure the liver span. Normally it should be from 6 to 12 centimeters. Remember, if you felt the lower edge of the liver, you should comment on the size, consistency, and tenderness. Now we move on to the spleen. In the spleen, we also start from the right lower quadrant and we palpate during inspiration and move during expiration. So starting from the right lower quadrant and we move obliquely. If we didn't feel the spleen, we should ask the patient to lie on his right side and start palpating in the same way, but this time starting from the midline rather than the right lower quadrant. If we didn't feel the spleen again, we should percuss in the last intercostal space on the anterior axillary line. Normally it should be resonant. If dull, it might indicate splenomegaly. You can further check for splenomegaly by asking the patient to take a deep breath and hold. Then you percuss on the same point. Now for the kidney, we only have palpation. Keep your non-dominant hand below the patient on the costovertebral angle and push upward and palpate the kidney using your dominant hand. The kidney can be felt in some cases like polycystic kidney disease. For the ascites, we have percussion only and it is divided into two parts. Shifting dullness, which is for minimal ascites, and fluid thrill, which is for massive ascites. In shifting dullness, we start just below the costal margin on the midline, going down all the way to the umbilicus. Then we make a 90 degrees turn and we move till we reach the flank. Normally the percussion should be resonant. In case of dullness, we ask the patient to turn to this side while we keep our finger on the same spot and wait for 10 seconds. Then we percuss again. If dullness persists, then it is a mass. If it becomes resonant, then it is fluid and it moved when the patient changed his position. For fluid thrill, the patient should put his hand on his abdomen like this, and we tap the abdomen from one side and feel the thrill by the other hand. Here is a picture that will help you understand it, as our patient is very thin to demonstrate it on him. The final part of the examination is the auscultation, and we have four things to auscultate for. First is the bowel sounds. Using the diaphragm of the stethoscope, start from the right lower quadrant and wait for 30 seconds. Then move to the next quadrant and wait for other 30 seconds, till you auscultate all four quadrants with total time of 2 minutes. You shouldn't always wait for 2 minutes, you only wait in case you can't hear any bowel sounds. Once you hear bowel sounds, you can stop. Then comment on the bowel sounds whether they are present or absent, and hypoactive, normal or hyperactive. Next is the auscultation for aortic bruit, using the bell of the stethoscope. Next is the auscultation for renal bruit, again using the bell of the stethoscope. And last is the auscultation of the organs, the liver and the spleen, checking for venous hum, which may indicate portal hypertension. Now to end our examination, we need to remember four things: pitting edema, genital examination, anorectal examination, and hernial orifices. Then DRTH. Drape the patient, report to your senior doctor, thank the patient, hand washing. This is the end of the examination. Soon we will be posting a brief version of this video, which will help you as a revision before your exam. Thanks for watching.